فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل واشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل واشهد ان سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى اله واصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. We are in the sharh of the kitab متن أبي شجاع. We are in the مقدمة. We were speaking about or given a مدخل إلى علم الفقه, an introduction to the knowledge and the science of fiqh. We previously spoke about the two noble imams, الإمام أبو حنيفة رحمه الله. And we spoke about Al-Imam Malik ibn Anas rahimahullah. We spoke about the madhab, books of the madhab if you want to study it, mustalahat, terms that are used in each of the two madhabs, the prominent students of each of the two immas. We studied a good portion of the two madhabs, the madhab al-Hanafiyya and the madhab al-Malikiyya. Today, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to go into المذهب الشافعي, the Shafi'i madhab, and this is the بيت القصيد. This is the thing that we particularly want more than the rest. Reason is because the kitab that we're going to go into, which is متن أبي شجاع, is a Shafi'i book. So it's we need more to understand this madhab than the rest. So before we start talking about the madhab, we always start by speaking about التعريف بإمام المذهب. We start by speaking about the Imam of the Madhab. And the Imam of the Madhab is Muhammad ibn Idris ibn al-Abbas ibn Uthman ibn Shafi' ibn Sa'ib ibn Ubaid ibn Abd Yazid ابن هشام ابن المطلب ابن عبد مناف ابن قصي ابن كلاب. So Shafi'i is what? مطلبي قرشي. الإمام الشافعي is a مطلبي. مطلب means he is the children of Hashim ibn al-Muttalib. Very good. So him and the Prophet ﷺ meet where? Hashim ibn al-Muttalib. He's مطلبي Qurashiyu. He comes to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam exactly from Abdi Manaf ibn Qusay onwards. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i was born when the Islamic calendar was 150 Hijriya. And that is said to be the year which the noble Imam, Al-Imam Abu Hanifa, died. ولذلك the scholars, they say, مات فيها إمام وولد فيها إمام. An Imam died that year and an Imam was born that year. The Imam that died that year was who? Al-Imam Abu Hanifa. The Imam that was born that year was who? Al-Imam Shafi'i. So the Imam that died that year was Abu Hanifa. And the Imam that was born that year was Al-Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, he was born in Gaza. وَحُمِلَ إِلَى مَكَّةَ, and he was taken to Mecca. وَهُوَ ابْنُ سَنَتَيْنِ, and he was only 2 years of age when he was taken from Gaza to Mecca. Then after that, he left Mecca, ثُمَّ انْتَقَلَ إِلَى الْمَدِينَةِ. Then he went to Medina after that. ثُمَّ قَدِمَ بَغْدَادِ. Then he went to Baghdad after that. فَأَقَامَ فِيهَا سَنَتَيْنِ, he stayed there for 2 years. ثم رجع إلى مكة, and then he came back to Mecca. ثم قدم إلى بغداد مرة ثانية. Then he came to Baghdad again, and he remained there for a month, and then he went to Egypt and he died there. So that's a quick round trip that we mentioned of Al-Imam Al-Shafi'i rahimahullah. كان الشافعي فصيح اللسان. Al-Imam Shafi'i, he was eloquent in his speech. ولذلك The a'immatul lugha in nahu, grammar, yahtajuna bi kalamihi. They use his speech as a hujjah, as a proof. Shafi'i, his speech is Arabic, is a hujjah, is a proof. The grammarians, they use it. For example, they would say, grammatical analysis, where they grammatically analyze a word, and they say, this is wajhun min wujuhil Arab. This is a usage used by the Arabs. And if somebody says, who? They say, Shafi'i used it. And there are times which some people try to criticize Shafi'i in matters of grammar, they try to, and correct him on it. Are you with me? And it turned out to be that Shafi'i was right and they were wrong. And we're going to see one example like that, the many, but we'll see one example, inshallah, in the tafsir of Surah An-Nisa. When we come to it, inshallah ta'ala, when Allah says, وَآتُوا النِّسَاءَ صَدُقَاءً وَآتُوا الْيَتَامَ أَمْوَالَهُمْ وَلَا تَتَبَدَّلُوا خَبِيثَ بِالطَّيِّبِ وَلَا تَأْكُلُوا أَمْوَالَهُمْ إِنَّهُمْ كَانَ حُبًا كَبِيلًا وَلَن تَسْتَطِعَ أَن تَعْدِلُوا بَيْنَ النِّسَاءِ وَلَوْ حَرَصْتُمْ فَلَا تَمِيلُوا كُلَّ الْمَيْلِ فَتَذَرُوهَا كَالْمُعَلَّى. It's not it. We'll see Surah An-Nisa. There's a word in Surah An-Nisa where we will come across where Al-Imam al-Shafi'i rahimahullah gave a meaning to it. ذَلِكَ أَدْنَى أَلَّا تَعُولُوا. When Allah said, ذَلِكَ أَدْنَى أَلَّا تَعُولُوا. The word عُولُوا in Surah An-Nisa. Are you with me? Shafi'i gave a meaning to it. The Aymatul Lugha said, that's wrong. Arabs don't use it that way. And it turned out to be Shafi'i being right. And it being a language used by the what? It was used by the Ahlul Himyir. So Shafi'i, rahimahullah, he is what? He is from the people whose language is used. ولذلك, sometimes, A'immatul Lugha, they would correct their poetry based on Imam al-Shafi'i's language. If you go to the Kitab Manaqib al-Shafi'i, page 2, second volume, page 44 to 47, you'll see some examples like that. If you even go to the Kitab al-Intiqa by Ibn Abdul Barr, page 92 to 93, Manaqib also, page 2, 41 to 44. If you go to the Kitab al-Zahir fi Gharib al-Alfaz al-Shafi'i by Azhari, if you look at the Kitab, Khutbatul Kitab al-Mu'ammal lil-Raddi'i ila al-Amr al-Awwal by Ibn Shamit al-Maqdisi, page 74 to 75. If you look at the Kitab, Tahdhib al-Asma'i wal-Lughat by Al-Imam al-Nawawi, first volume, page 49 to 50. If you look at the Muqaddimah al-Tahqiq al-Risala, if you look at the Muqaddimah of the Kitab, which he done Tahqiq of Ahmad Shakir, Kitab al-Risala, he speaks about that as well, page 13 to page 14. So Shafi'i is imam min a'immat al-lugha as well. Kana fasih al-lisan. His tongue was very fasih, far from mistakes and grammatical errors. Rawiyat al-shi'ri. He would bring about poetry. Wa kana qawiy al-hafidh. Wa kana qawiy al-hafidha. Shafi'i's memorization was excessively strong. Wa kana husn al-qira'a min sigharihi. He used to read very well when he was young. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, he came to Al-Imam Malik, وَقَدْ حَفِظَ الْمُوَطَّى. He came to Imam Malik, and he had memorized the Muwatta. What did he memorize? He memorized the Muwatta. He memorized it. Before he came to Imam Malik, first of all. He memorized the Muwatta, and then he came to Imam Malik, rahimahullah. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i, rahimahullah, he's an Imam al-Mujma'un ala imamati. His imamah is unanimously agreed upon. وَكَانَ مِنْ أَذْكِيَاءِ الدُّنْيَا. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i was from the most smartest imams of his time, or individuals of his time. Some of the ulama, they said, some of the people of knowledge, they said to Imam al-Shafi'i, أَنَا لَكَ أَن تُفْتِيَ. It's now right for you to give fatwa. وَهُوَ ابْنُ خَمْسَةَ عَشَرَ سَنَةً. And he was only 15 years of age. Shafi'i was only 15 years of age, and they said to him, now it's your time to give fatwa. You can give fatwa. So the scholars, they gave him the rights to give fatwa, and he was only 15 years of age. And this shows you, هذا من بركة العلم, the blessings of knowledge. How many people who were young, كبره العلم, knowledge is what magnified them and made them old. And how many people were old, صغره الجهل, ignorance made them young. They were old in age, but what made them little and nothing is ignorance. And everything a person tries to get themselves seem to be big, it goes. Whatever you try to find that will, you seem to think that will make you big, it will go. It really won't last for long, except knowledge. If your knowledge is full of blessings and you've learned the right knowledge, then that person, without a shadow of a doubt, he will be old. He would be a person who's old in age, old in wisdom and brain. And Imam Shafi'i, due to his excessive knowledge and his striving in knowledge from a very young age, the people of knowledge, they allowed him to give fatwa with them, and he's only 15 years of age. And Imam Shafi'i, rahimahullah, he was mutawadi'an, he was a very humble individual. يُحِبُّ أَن يُظْهِرَ الْحَقُّ. He loved the truth to become apparent and clear. And he never used to look at himself. وَلِذَلِكَ رَبِيعُ بْنُ سُلَيْمَانَ الْمُرَادِي, he said, I heard Shafi'i say, when he was ill, I heard Shafi'i said, say, وَدِدْتُ, I wish, أَنَّ الْخَلْقَ يَعْلَمُونَ, that the people know. مَا فِي هَذِهِ الْكُتُبِ, they know what's in these books. Meaning they know knowledge. عَلَىٰ أَلَّا أَنْ يَنْسِبُوا إِلَيَّ مِنْهَا شَيْئًا, as long as they don't attribute anything to me. I just wish the people learn the truth and they know what is right from what is wrong and they don't attribute anything to me. And Imam Shafi'i, his aqidah was on point. It was the aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And he used to hate, rahimahullah ta'ala, Imam Shafi'i, for a person to go towards ilmul kalam, philosophy. And he used to say, الْأَنْ يُبْتَلَ الْمَرْءُ بِكُلِّ مَا نَهَى اللَّهُ عَنْهُ مَا عَدَى الشِّرْكِ خَيْرٌ لَهُ مِنْ أَنْ يَنْظُرَ فِي الْكَلَامِ. For a person to be tested with everything Allah prohibited besides killing, besides shirk. So may Allah test you with killing people or zina or lying or whatever. Are you with me, brothers and sisters? All of that is nothing compared to a person who's been tested with ilmul kalam. The only thing, ilmul kalam, is higher than it is shirk. For Allah to test you with everything other than shirk is better for you than to look into ilmul kalam. Allahu Akbar, that's a big statement. All of the sins that there are other than shirk, for Allah to test you with that and you go through that and you do that is better for you. خَيْرٌ لَهُ مِنْ أَنْ يَنْظُرَ إِلَى الْكَلَامِ, that you look into ilmul kalam. And Imam Shafi'i used to say, حُكْمِ فِي أَصْحَابِ الْكَلَامِ, my ruling on the people who look towards ilm al-kalam is, أَنْ يُضْرَبُوا بِالْجَرِيدِ وَيُحْمَلُوا عَلَى الْإِبِلِ وَيُطَافُ بِهِ فِي الْعَشَائِرِ وَالْقَبَائِلِ يُقَالُ هَذَا جَزَاءُ مَنْ تَرَكَ الْكِتَابَ وَالسُّنَّةِ وَأَخَذَ بِالْكَلَامِ. My ruling regarding those who look into ilm al-kalam, who speak about it, philosophy and whatnot, أَنْ يُضْرَبُوا بِالْجَرِيدِ, that they are whipped with branches and with shoes, bil jarid wal ni'al, and shoes. وَيُحْمَلُوا عَلَى الْإِبْلِ, and then they carried, some of the riwayat they mentioned, he's taken on a donkey, some say it's a camel, and he's paraded, يُطَافُ بِهِ فِي الْعَشَائِرِ وَالْقَبَائِلِ, and he's paraded in the market, and in the tribe, and in the city, and the village, he's paraded. And it said to the people, هَذَا جَزَاءُ مَنْ تَرَكَ الْكِتَابُ وَالسُّنَّةِ, this is the reward of the person who turns away from the kitab and the sunnah, وَأَخَذَ بِالْكَلَامِ, who takes theories, philosophy. So what is he honoring here? What is he honoring here? Imam Shafi'i, he's honoring ta'azimu al-kitab wa sunnah. He's honoring the kitab and the sunnah and the seriousness of taking it. And in the severity and the dangers of the person who turns away from the kitab and the sunnah. And Imam Shafi'i, he used to urge and he used to push his students and the people around him to study in fiqh, learning fiqh. He used to say, عَلَيْكَ بِالْفِقْهِ, upon you is fiqh. Go and study fiqh. Because it's through fiqh a person hata learns manners and etiquettes. And it's through fiqh a person learns how to deal with people who oppose him on issues that are correct and a valid difference of opinion. He will learn it through fiqh. Al-Imam al-Shafi'i was sahibu hikmatin. He was a person of wisdom. وَلَوْ دُوِّنَا مُؤَلَّفٌ فِي الْحِكَمِ الْمَأْثُورَةِ عَنِ الْإِمَامِ الشَّافِعِي لَكَانَ كَبِيرًا. Somebody sat down and they put together the wisdom that were gathered from Shafi'i. I promise you that would be a big book. Somebody sat down to gather all of the wise statements that Shafi'i said and they were to put it into a book. It would be volumes. Not a volume, but volumes. One of the examples for his wise statements was, is صُحْبَةُ مَنْ لَا يَخَافُ اللَّهِ عَارٌ, he used to say. Befriending, the one who doesn't fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is an embarrassment. It's a harm. Befriending a person who does not fear Allah, who has no khawf and khashya of Allah, he's going to bring you problems. He's going to drag harm for you. One of the wise statements that he used to say. This is a hikmah which is azimah, that a person requires it a lot in their life. One of the wise statements that he used to say is, يَنْبَغِي لِلْرَجُلِ أَنْ يَتَوَخَّى لِصُحْبَتِهِ أَهْلَ الْوَفَاءِ وَالصِّدْقِ كَمَا يَتَوَخَّى لِوَدِيعَتِهِ أَهْلَ الثِّقَةِ وَالْأَمَانَةِ. That a person should choose a friend. He should choose a friend who is reliable, a friend who is truthful. He should choose a friend who is reliable and truthful, just like he chooses a reliable, a trustworthy person to give his properties to. Because the reason why Shafi'i is saying this is because the friend that you're choosing, you're entrusting him with your own self. You're entrusting this person with yourself. صح? I'm trusting you with myself, that you're going to take me to what's good, right? And the same is when you give a person your property. You're trusting them with your property that you've given them. One of the wise statements that Shafi'i said, rahimahullah, rahmatan wasi'a, is what? أَظْلَمُ الظَّالِمِينَ لِنَفْسِهِ. One of the most oppressive individuals to himself is الَّذِي إِذَا ارْتَفَعَ جَفَى أَقَارِبَهُ. The person who, when he becomes high, he elevates a bit, you know, he achieves something in life, he cuts off his family. وَأَنْكَرَ مَعَارِفَهُ. And he dismisses and rejects the people who he once knew, his friends, his colleagues. وَاسْتَخَفَّ بِالْأَشْرَافِ. And then he belittles the honorable people. وَتَكَبَّرَ عَلَى ذَوِي الْفَضْلِ. And he is arrogant over those who are virtuous. A little bit. He rises a little bit. He elevates a little bit. A couple of thousand here and there. And automatically he forgets his family. He doesn't want to hear his mom. He doesn't want to know where his dad is. He doesn't want to know. He doesn't remember where he's from, his roots. He forgets everything. He also, those who knew him when he was nothing, he walks away from them like they are nothing. He also starts to belittle other people who are honorable and virtuous. He's arrogant over them. These are one of the statements of Al-Imam al-Shafi'i. It's from the hikam, the wisdom that he said, rahimahullah. One of the powerful statements that Shafi'i also said is, مَنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ عَفِيفًا. Anyone who is not chaste, لَمْ يَزَلْ سَخِيفًا. He will remain سخيف. Somebody who is weak and pathetic. وَمَنْ اِهْتَمَّ بِالْمَعَاصِي. And anyone who gives consideration is always into doing sins. He's always focused on accomplishing sins. He's always working towards sins. لَمْ يَزَلْ خَائِفًا. That person will remain fearful in the rest of his life. ذَلِيلًا. Humiliated. He'll always be scared. Anxiety, Allahu Akbar. Dalilan, he'll feel humiliated. He feels low. He feels low all the time. Why? Ma'asi. Powerful statement. وَمَنْ اِهْتَمَّ بِالْمَعَاصِي. Anyone who gives importance to sins, you'll always find them tell you, I'm suicidal. Sahih? I don't know why I live. This person has anxieties. This person is depressed. True. Have you seen that? You find that. Research that person. Look at them. اهتم بالمعاصي. He gives importance to the sins. He's doing sins. So he's fearful. He's scared. يحسبون كل صيحة عليهم. Every statement that is said, he thinks people are directing it at him. He comes to the masjid. He listens to people talking. He's like, I don't want to come to the masjid. Everyone is looking at me. No one's looking at you. أنت خائف. People are always judging me. No one's judging you. تخائف. Because of your sins. When I go to the khutbah, the khatib, he looks at me when he talks. No, he's not. He's looking towards your direction. أنت خائف. Are you with me, brothers? If you take these statements and you apply it on the situation of the time that we're living in, and you place it on people who send you messages and emails, and you ask that, this statement comes to you, which is, وَمَنِ اهْتَمَّ بِالْمَعَاصِي. This person is giving so much consideration to sins and disobedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what's happened? Sins, they place in your heart fear. You're scared. All day you think to yourself and you're thinking in your heart all day that everybody's out there to get you. That's what you think. Everyone wants to pull the rug on you. Everybody wants to mug you. Everybody wants to take away from you. Everybody's out there. No one is out there for you. People are doing their thing. And you feel dhaleel. You feel like everybody's humiliating you. No, because you feel in your heart humiliated. You're humiliated. That's what's happened. Being chaste is what raises you up. By being afif, by protecting your desires is what raises you up. It pushes you up. It's what makes you honorable. Once you leave off being chaste, wallahi, you're never going to be raised. You know why you're not going to be raised? How can you be above others and be above the community you're from if you couldn't even overcome your own desires? Your own desires overpowers you. And you can't be on top of your own desires. How would you be on top of the problems in the community or the people that you're from? You can't. You can't. So these are the statements that Shafi'i rahimahullah, he said. This chapter of, as I said to you before, the hikam inda Shafi'i, Imam Shafi'i's hikam, in reality is a babun azimun jidda. It's a big chapter. It's a big chapter. If a person sat down and gathered all of the hikam from Shafi'i and he done a muhadara, wallahi, I would personally believe that would be a muhadara mati'ah. It would be a very powerful muhadara. Gathering all of the wise statements of Imam Shafi'i from the books that I mentioned in and his diwan and others, it would be very nice. The ulama, they praised Shafi'i a lot. And the example for that is, one of the best examples for that is Ishaq ibn Rahuya. Ishaq ibn Rahuya, his name is said in two ways. It's said as Rahuya and Rahawiya. Both ways you can say it. Ishaq ibn Rahuya, we should say Rahuya because the scholars of hadith, they say Rahuya. The scholars of grammar, they say Rahawiya ala Sibawiya, ala Sigati Sibawiya. Sah? Ishaq ibn Rahuya, he said, Laqiyani Ahmad ibn Hanbal. Ahmad ibn Hanbal met me in Mecca. فقال لي إمام أحمد said to إسحاق بن راهوية. He said to me, تعال, come with me. أحمد رحمه الله said to شافعي, sorry, he said to إسحاق بن راهوية, come with me. حتى أريك رجلا لم تر عيناك مثله. Let me show you a person who your eyes have never seen the likes of him. فأراني شافعي. He showed me إمام شافعي. Abdullah ibn Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he said, Ya Abati, my father, أي رجل كان الشافعي فإني أسمعك تكثر الدعاء له. Abdullah ibn Ahmad, he said to Imam Ahmad, رحمه الله, his father, Abdullah ibn Imam Ahmad, and Imam Ahmad's son, Abdullah, he asked his father, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, he said, Dad, who is this man, Shafi'i? Why? Because I hear you a lot making dua for him, excessive in the dua that you make for him. Wallahi, Allahu Akbar. Allahu Akbar. Al-ulama yatarahamuna fima baynahum. The ulama having mercy amongst themselves, recognizing each other's virtue. والذين جاءوا من بعدهم يقولون ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان. Oh Allah, forgive us. Have mercy upon us. And also have mercy and bestow your never-ending mercy onto those who have preceded us in righteousness. Today when a person becomes something and he learns a bit of ilm here or there, he forgets those who have preceded him in good and ilm and virtue upon the sunnah. He forgets them. He forgets those who have preceded him in age and in good. Ahlul Sunnah, their characteristics is يترحمون. They are merciful towards each other. ويدعو بعضهم لبعض. They make dua for one another. ويستغفر بعضهم لبعض. And they ask forgiveness for one another. And they recognize each other's virtue and each other's status and each other's position. They recognize that. Even if they differ with each other in masail, even if they differ with each other in matters of the religion, they are still in recognition of each other's virtue and how noble this person is. And one of the people I personally remember in this country, when I go to cities, small villages, I go to small towns, I go little places, I go to Stoke-on-Trent, little like place up north, and then I just hear somebody tell me, I learned Tawheed, Jameel, وَمَنْ عَلَّمَكَ, who taught you it? And he says to me, Abu Suhaib Bassam taught me. Abu Suhaib came and he taught Kitab al-Tawheed in this city, this village, this town. Allahu Akbar. He came here and he taught you this. Yes. عَدَدُ لَا يُحْصَى. Numbers that cannot be counted, who have come to me and said to me, I was a Brelwi or I was a Diobandi, and after Allah, Allah guided me with the hands of Sheikh Abu Suhaib Bassam. He guided me to the Tawheed and the Sunnah. He taught me the ahmiyyah, the power and the weight that the Sunnah of the Prophet should have. And the Tawheed and Aqeedah, the way it should be seen. Your heart will be in a state of love. A person who's working towards spreading Tawheed in places, Ya Ikhwa. It's little. Stoke-on-Trent is a small place. Many places like that you go to, you hear him teaching there. Or you hear people coming up to you and saying to you, he's the one I learned this from. So what you do for him is that, Allahumma arhamhu. Oh Allah, have mercy upon him. Oh Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, forgive him. Oh Allah, honor him. Oh Allah, make the truth flow of his tongue. That's what you would say. You won't have enmity towards him or hate. You would have love for a person like that. Like in the person who opposes the sunnah, who calls away from the sunnah, and deviates the people away from the sunnah, your issue with him is not personal. Wallahi abadan, it's not. Your issue with him is that he's an obstacle to what? To the tawheed and the sunnah. He's bringing about fasad and corruption. That's what you have with him. So what do you say to that individual? May Allah guide you and bring you back to the truth. Or may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala silence you from the harm that you bring into the ummah. Are you with me? So Imam Ahmad rahimahullah, the reason why he's making Imam Ahmad Shafi'i and making dua excessively for him is his brother who stood up to spread the sunnah. But like Shafi'i was called what? Nasir al-Sunnah, that was his name. Shafi'i's name, his nickname, his laqab was Nasir al-Sunnah. He used to be called that. That's what Shafi'i rahimahullah was known as. So he would make dua for him. He would ask forgiveness for him. That doesn't mean Shafi'i and Ahmad saw eye to eye in every masail in the religion. Abadan, you will never. But they both unanimously agreed upon the creed of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. And they were in line with that. So they loved each other. So he used to make dua for him. And he would not forget him. And then Imam Ahmad responded by saying, and Imam Ahmad responded to his son, he said, Ya Abati. He said, Ya Bunayya, my son, كان الشافعي رحمه الله كالشمس للدنيا. Shafi'i is like the sun for this world. وكالعافية للناس, and he's a cure, and he's like a cure for the human being. How much do you need a cure? How much do we need the sun? That's Shafi'i, how he is to us. فانظر هل لهذين من عوض. Look, is there anything that can take the place of the sun, and is there anything that can take the place of a cure? Nothing. Shafi'i had no one that could take his place. Allahu Akbar. And Imam Ahmad, rahimahullah, he said, ما صليت صلاةً I never prayed a salah منذ 40 سنة for 40 years إلا وأنا أدعو فيها للشافعي except I supplicate and I make dua for Imam Shafi'i. Allahu Akbar.